So Gary, got a lot on this weekend. You got a rally to try and win, and more importantly, a championship to try and win as well.
Yeah, without a doubt. You know, we started off at the start of the year wanting this championship really, really badly, and it hasn't changed much. So it's very nerve-wracking for us. You know, the rally is here to win, surely, but the championship's more important to me at the minute. But I know when the helmet goes on tomorrow morning, it'll be a different story.
There's a great deal of effort gone into this because this is the first one, isn't it?
Yeah, definitely. You know, we've worked so hard for it. We've come up through the Peugeots, the Mitsubishis, and it's our first real year in a World Rally car. And to be up there, you know, and to be truthful, it's ours to throw away, but we have to keep our heads down and do the hunt stupid.
So, Breed, after everything that has happened, it has come down to this. The Irish Tarmac Championship 2013 is going to be decided on the streets around Mill Street.
That's right, John. It is the Cork 20 International Rally, an historical event, of course. And Gary Jennings and Rory Kennedy here to write their own history. Can they be crowned Tarmac Rally Champions 2013?
So, Breed, as Gary and Rory leave the ramp, let's preview the opening stages.
Day one sees the crews tackle seven stages, two loops of three, with an extra stage at the end of the day to keep the drivers on their toes right to the finish.
It's another beautiful day in Ireland, and this is the place to be. This is the start of stage one, with Gary Jennings going for his maiden Tarmac Championship, and Donna Kelly wondering whether his car is going to stall before he's even started the rally.
First on the road would be last year's winners Dara O'Riordan and Tony McDade. The pair back to try and make it three in a row on this event and put themselves right in the mix of that championship battle. The pair end the first loop of stages in second place, 18 seconds behind the rally leaders. As we heard, Gary Jennings didn't have to do anything silly here this weekend. Just play it safe and concentrate on that championship fight. Third at this stage was enough to do that, but with moments like this on the opening stage, he would need to tidy things up if he wanted to see the finish of the day, let alone the finish of the event. For Declan and Brian Boyle, it would be a great start. 18 seconds in the lead after the opening loop. And while they may not be in the championship battle, they were here for one thing, and that was to win.
Four left for 6 right fast out. Absolute crest. And one left long, absolute. And a slippy 3 right, big cut. Slippy 3 right, shiny. And a one left straight after it, breaking for 4 right cut. Breaking out for 4 right cut. 4 right cut. One left long, absolute. To care, 6 right, double tight. 6 right, double tight. Double tight, 6 right. Yeah, yeah. Care ahead, 3 left over a dip. And the stop dead on the crest here for 3 right, shiner, square right. Stop dead. That's good. Lovely. 100. With care, 4 right, shiny. Use the road.
So that leaves Donna Kelly and Kevin Flanagan. The pair worried the car's launch would cause problems, but for the first stage at least it seemed okay. They lie in fourth place, and importantly in their battle just 9 seconds behind Jennings at this stage. As well as the battles up front, the Group N battle would be close. Colin Murphy and Don Montgomery coming out on top of that on the opening stages, but with only a 5 second lead. As with the top of the timesheets, there would be overall and championship battles this weekend in Group N. And for Owen Murphy and James O'Brien, it would be the overall they really had their eyes on. They lie second in the class after Stage 3. Kevin Kelleher and Jared Conway hadn't always had the best of luck on some of their outings this season, so it would be hard to tell at this early stage how things were going, but 7th was a good place to start and build on for the rest of the event. Sebastian Ling and Ali Dries would be the first of the overseas crews to show in the results. Mixing themselves into the Group N fight, it would be 3rd in the class for the Welsh pair, and of course lying 8th overall too. For Stephen and Suzanne Wright, the Group N battle would be about the championship. Just like Jennings, they had to calculate the difference between pushing for overall victory or playing it safe and taking the title, which they were doing well at this stage with 4th in the class and 9th overall. Sam Moffat and James O'Reilly had encountered a small problem in the opening stage when the exhaust became loose on the car and was dragging on the ground. They ran stages 2 and 3 with half of the exhaust missing, but thankfully the stages times were okay and they lie in 10th place. At the end of the opening loop, a reminder of the top of the leaderboard.
Declan, what on earth did you have for breakfast this morning? You went off like a rocket.
That Weetabix is great stuff.
And the rest of them, they're struggling to catch you up now.
Well, see, Darren's putting on the pressure there now. He took 2 out of us on the second one and 2 on the third. So I think there's about 18 seconds on it. But it's a long rally yet, so we're just going to carry on, you know, batter away the way we are.
Did you expect to be here, leading the rally so early?
No, we didn't. We just went out and, you know, do what we normally do. Just, you know, go as hard as we can and try and keep it safe. But we done that, and the time was good. There was a couple of hairy ones now because we felt there was a couple of them, a few corners tightened on us, but we got around them anyway. But I think it was 22 seconds we got on the first stage there.
And listen, if you were Gary Jennings now, with a championship to consider as well, what would you do if you were in his boots?
I would back off completely.
Wise words.
No, but in fairness, he can't go mad. He needs to finish. He has to finish.
I know, Dara, it would be your aim to make this a hat-trick of wins at the Cork 20 this weekend. However, not really a good start for you today.
No, the first stage, I think we were too cautious and I just went awake and I didn't drive well and at all. And I thought it'd be a lot worse than it was then, and it wasn't that bad. So it wasn't too bad then. The next two, I kind of got a bit more comfortable and I was happier. But I'm not too bad.
Did you have issues with the tyre on the opening stage?
No, I had the right tyre and I had everything right. I just didn't drive the car. It was just me. I just didn't drive it because I had the right tyres and everything. I had loads of grip and everything. I just didn't drive on.
Gary, you're smiling, but tell me about the car dumping water on the stage, if I heard this correctly.
Yeah, we just had a slight problem at halfway through the first stage. She dumped the water and started overheat, but these cars do that. You know, we've spoke to Pro Drive and the 12Bs do that, and it's just getting around that complication. But no, we got it at the end of the stage and we got water in it and we screwed it down a bit on the activator and put it on lag one and it's perfect now again. So it's one of them things, you just have to live with it, just not push it too hard.
What was the conversation like in the car when it happened? I bet it was a surprise, wasn't it?
Well, it wasn't about pulling in anyway. It was going to blow up, but it was going to blow up. No, it was grand. You know, I know the car now and I've seen it coming and it just come on. So I knew what to do. I turned off the lag and all and started to drive it nice and canny and it come back on strong again. But a wee bit scary, but it's happened now 2 rallies. I know what to do and it's just great to get it back in service. The boys can check it over. They can see nothing wrong. They can build the water pressure back up again.
Look, Gary, the timesheets don't lie. It's so far so good. You are pretty much where you want to be in the championship.
Yeah, without a doubt. You know, we were second there going to the last stage. We don't need to be there. You know, me and Roy discussed this. We don't need to be up there pushing with these boys. So we'll just back now, find a pace and hopefully work from there.
10 behind Gary at the moment, but are you content there?
Didn't have a great run now in the last stage. First two weren't too bad. Last stage seemed to just not get into the rhythm right. No fault of the car, really. It's just myself. So, but no, happy enough. It's a long way to go. 3 stages done.
And the launch control problem, has it happened on each stage so far this morning?
It's not as bad as it was, but we're getting, when we come off the line, then the car kind of floods itself and then clears. But it's costing us a bit of time. Nothing substantial.
Roy White and Liam Brennan would be fastest out of the blocks early on day one, the pair complaining of being a little cautious on the opening stage and an alternator problem in stage 3 losing them a little time, but their concerns didn't stop them from having a 21 second lead after stage 3. Overseas visitor and rallying legend Phil Collins had this time teamed up with Adrian Deasy after Adrian's usual driver Alan Ring was sidelined with injury before the rally. Things were going well so far with second place in the national rally. For Wesley Patterson and Sean Hewitt it would be third. Things were going well, just 16 seconds behind Collins, but they had encountered some time loss when they stopped at an accident in stage 3. That accident was Frank Kelly. The Escort driver had been having a good run up to that point, being up in third overall. But this blow to the event meant Super Rally was the best he could hope for, but thankful at least that everyone was okay. Jim McKenna and Thomas Trainer were having a good start to the event, just a minute down on the rally lead and 23 seconds behind Patterson in the class battle in fourth overall. For Jason Ryan and Tygo Sullivan, it would be fifth place. the pair having a good run in the Starlet to lie just 14 seconds behind McKenna.
Well, we find these very comfortable seats halfway through stage four. Knocknacilla.
We got the clock out so we can measure the splits. And what did Declan Boyle say in service? He wanted to take a couple of seconds out the guys behind him. And if he can and has, we'll find it here on this left-hander. Let's see what the clock shows. So here comes Darragh O'Riordan. Let's start the clock now. And see how Gary Jennings' time compares with Darragh at this point. Here comes Gary now. And by my calculation, he's made up some time there, so that's looking good for Gary's championship.
Yeah, it looks like a substantial 4 seconds at this halfway point on stage four.
Well done, Gary. Coming up next, Declan Boyle. Set the time there. By my reckoning, Declan's made up time as well. Bree, do you agree?
Yes, definitely. And he did say in service that he wasn't going to let Darragh O'Riordan run away with it here today.
And he's on it. This is Donna Kelly. She'll be coming past us just now. Here he is. Well, I reckon Donna's lost time there. Something in the region of between 9 and 10 seconds to this point. That's bad news if that's right.
The times in stage four may not have changed things too much, but in the following stage, things do change as we lose Declan and Brian Boyle from the rally lead with an unfortunate crash on stage five. They continue, but drop down to 11th overall now.
On stage four, we had a good time through stage four, but we burst a suspension on the left-hand side. And then we were just cautious with it on stage five, but we went up on top of a bank, and in slow motion, the car fell over on its side, so we blocked the stage.
Where does this leave you now? What's the plan?
We're nowhere in the championship, and we're not going to win the rally now because we're 5 minutes behind or whatever. So I don't know whether we should carry on or not.
So this means a move up into the lead now for Darragh O'Riordan and Tony McDade. Their job made a little easier with the loss of Boyle from the lead, but the times were improving anyway.
Darragh, how'd it go in there? I'm looking for a smile on your face.
Not too bad, no. We had a good run in there. So with the tyres we had were a bit soft for it, like, but with the cuts in them and things, it was bone dry. But no, it went well. No, I enjoyed it. Like, so that's what it's about. So.
All this means that it's a move into second for Gary Jennings and Rory Kennedy. But would this move up the order promote a change of mind and a push for the overall win?
Gary, how did it go?
Yeah, nice and steady. Obviously, Dara and them know that stage very well. I've never done it before, so no, it's grand. Hey, this is where you want to be, but it's very hard to drive not flat out, you know, and trying to think about the championship, but it's nearly one day over now.
It's tempting now, you're in second.
Yeah, it's tempting, but no. Darragh knows this place too well to push him down here, but we'll see tomorrow morning what happens if we get through tonight, because it's a different territory again.
For Donna Kelly and Kevin Flanagan, it would still be second of the championship hopefuls. They lie in third overall, but it was just 18 seconds difference.
Donna, tell me all about it. How did it go?
Launch problem is back, and I've no handbrake now either, so I'm having to drive the hairpins because the handbrake thinks it's on all the time, so all the diffs are released, so we had to disconnect it there. So challenging.
You're still smiling though.
Jesus, good fun.
And the place is drying out as well.
Yeah, it's not too bad. It's nice here this afternoon, you know, so yeah, we'll keep at it.
Kevin Kelleher and Ger Conway make some changes to the tyre choice for this loop of stages, and it pays off with a move up into fourth place now, fighting with the rest of the WRC cars where he wanted to be.
Kevin, you're smiling.
Yeah, smiling. Good run last stage. The sweat's coming out of him, you know. Great run the last two. Unfortunately, we picked the wrong tyre this morning and we paid the price for it. So we're having a good cut now after dinner.
You're into it now. The rally's begun good and proper.
Oh, very good. Now, just classic stages and a great rally.
So you wanted to go on all day, do you?
No, I want this not to stop at all anyway.
The Group N battles would take a shake-up in these stages as Owen Murphy and James O'Brien take the lead in the class in fifth overall.
Owen, are you falling in love with this tarmac?
Yeah, it's a big change. Once again, I haven't driven on tarmac since March, so it is a change. We were after taking the morning to get back into it, but we've had some group end stage wins, so we're happy enough with that. So we'll try and push harder and harder as the weekend progresses.
Car's fine, no issues to worry about?
Yeah, it seems fine. We've no problems. The first stage this morning, I lost a ball of time because I had no confidence. I had no test in the car. I jumped straight into it. But we're going good. We're getting quicker and quicker as we go on.
And Sebastian Ling and Ali Dries would move into sixth, just 7 seconds behind Murphy and not letting him out of his sights. Sam Moffat and James O'Reilly were busy clawing back the time lost from this morning's misfortunes, but it wasn't looking too bad overall. Seventh place and third of the group end runners at this stage. For Stephen and Suzanne Wright, it would be a calculated drive to keep them in good position for the championship, eighth place and in the mix for the class, but importantly, where they needed to be for the title race.
Stephen, it's all drying out in there. Do you have a good time?
I'm not too sure. There's a few quick lads coming behind us there, but we'd quite a nice, sweet run through it now. We're not trying to find a lot of time in these guys. We're sort of in the middle of a battle for the championship with Josh Moffat, so we're trying to sort of keep our noses clean and at the same time stay concentrated, so it's not always easy.
Problems with an intercooler pipe this morning meant a slower start than Josh Moffat and John Rowan would have wanted. All repaired now and back out to see if they can play catch up and get themselves back in the race. But that deficit was over a minute to right now. And for Colin Murphy and Don Montgomery, their previous lead of Group N would now be over, dropping down to 10th overall and 6th in that battle after a puncture in Stage 6.
Colm, I'm hearing stories. What happened to you in there?
I just got a puncture on my front left. I was on some cut up to that, but don't know where the stone came from. Broke a seat bracket, so I'm getting slides in my seat and I'm getting slides in the car. But Monty did a great job getting me back on the notes, and, you know, we're enjoying it. We're here.
Well done. We'll let you go. You've got a bit of work to do.
I know, an awful lot. Cheers.
Just one more stage to go and a look at the top of the results. Over the next loop of stages, there wouldn't be any change at the top. Roy White and Liam Brennan still lead the way and are already starting to dominate the times. Now over 2 minutes of an advantage.
Roy, hello there. After five, we had you down as leader of the National. How's it feel?
Yeah, it feels good. It was very, very tricky this morning with the stages, but they've dried up now nicely. We've been able to put a good push on, so now we're having fun.
You prefer it dry, do you?
I prefer it dry. I don't mind it wet, but you know, you have a bit more fun in the dry.
No issues with the car to worry about?
No, we had an alternator failure there coming off this stage the last time, so we got that changed in service, so everything hunky-dory other than that.
All sweet and still smiling?
Yeah, still smiling, always good, you know, you're enjoying yourself.
Second place now, though, would be Wesley Patterson and Sean Head. They move up to this place in Stage 6 and have a lead in that position of 28 seconds.
Wesley, did you enjoy yourself in there?
Great. Haven't had so much fun in a rally car in a long time. Yeah.
Oh, come on, he can't have been that good.
It's no RS 1800, but it's a good pair of kit.
You entertaining in there then?
I lost a bit of time, maybe asking about spectators and pulling handbrakes where I shouldn't have done, but it's good fun.
You can't resist it, can you?
No, it's hard to grow up.
The reason for this sudden move up the results would be Phil Collins' drop down to fifth place. A puncture in Stage 6 lost the escort driver some time and makes the rest of the weekend that little bit harder now.
You've been out changing rubber.
Just got the puncture. Did about 7 or 8 miles on a flat. Rubber everywhere, heat, sweat under the armpits, all the stuff.
I thought you had staff to change all this kind of stuff.
We do back there, but not out there.
So it would be a move into third for Jim McKenna and Thomas Trainer. Collins' problems means a move up into this place for the pair. And another to benefit from that puncture would be Jason Ryan and Tygo Sullivan. They move up into fourth now in the Starlet, just 31 seconds behind McKenna. So with day one drawing to a close, let's take a quick look at the top of the classes. In class 9, we see an early lead from Timmy Foley and Barry Mead in the escort, and quite a substantial one, almost 5 minutes ahead of nearest class rivals, Declan Murphy and Daniel Hanratty in the Civic. Victor and Susan Beamish lead the way in class 10. The battle in this class not so comfortable though. A lead of only 23 seconds over second placed Kieran Casey and Erla McCarthy at the end of the day. Class 11F would see Jason Ryan and Tygo Sullivan leading the way. They hold a good advantage over West Cork's Damian McCarthy and Liam Moynihan in the Civic. In Class 11R, Paul Fitzgerald and Pierce Donaghy Jr. would also have a good lead. They extend the advantage to 2 minutes at the end of day one, over second place Mike Nelligan and John Hurley in the Corolla. Jared O'Connell and Tony Hennessy also hold a 2 minute lead in their class. They lead Class 12 over the starlet of Sean Hickey and Noel Fleming. Leonard Downey and Mark Murphy lead the way in Class 13, the pair already settling themselves into the top 10 in 7th place too. They lead the way over 2nd in class, Thomas O'Keefe and Jamie Keane, themselves in 9th overall in the results. Just the one crew in Class 15, so Danny Creedon and Jill White have a good run to lead the way home in that class. In Class 16, Ashley Dickinson and Aaron Johnson lead the way with a 2.5 minute advantage. That lead over the Impreza of Liam Dennehy and John Lynch. The historic category would bring a little more variety to the event, and leading the way in that category at the end of day one would be Mark Falvey and Peter Scott, the pair contesting the event in the ex-Billy Coleman car and not afraid of driving it like it should be. Their closest competition would be the escort of Dennis Moynihan and Shane Buckley. They lie just 43 seconds down in second place of the category. Aidan O'Connor and Ian Regan add another escort to the results in third place, just over 2 minutes back from the crew in front, the pair also leading the C3 class. John Spires and Susan Nicolum are the first of the non-escort crews in fourth. They lead the D4 class at this stage too. James O'Mahony and Kerry Barry end the day with quite a bit of cosmetic damage on the Volvo. But the important thing is they finish. They lie in 5th place and lead the B5 class. And James Power and Declan Kelly round off the historic category in 6th place in their Ford Escort, 35 seconds back from O'Mahony. The overall results wouldn't see much change in the final stage. Roy White and Liam Brennan continue to lead the way with that 2.5 minute advantage. Wesley Patterson and Sean Head remain in second, ending the day happy with the performance and looking forward to the battle on day two. Jim McKenna and Thomas Traynor start day two in a good position to take a good result away from this weekend. Third overall was good going for the escort pair. Jason Ryan and Tygo Sullivan hold on to that fourth place in the starlet, but only just. Their advantage now 6 seconds. 6 seconds to this pair, Phil Collins and Adrian Deasy. They are fighting back after their lost time, targeting Patterson as the benchmark for their day two push. Roy, this day just got continuously better for you.
It did. We had a problem with the alternator in the first loop of stages. We got that fixed and we got better and better and quicker all day. So no, we've had a real good day.
A very comfortable lead going into day two.
It is, but you know, a puncture would see that gone. So, you know, we still need to be careful tomorrow, but we'll still go for a push.
How do you feel about those 9 stages tomorrow?
I like them. They're very quick and I think the weather's going to be nice. So, you know, it'll make them super fast and, you know, plenty of bravery required in them as well. So we'll see how brave we're going to be.
7 stages out of the 16 down, Wesley. It's been a good day at the office for you.
Hi, we've had no real problems. Good run out. Stage a bit slippy this morning, but dried up this afternoon. A bit more of a cut on it now. And Bill Kirk with Jim McKenna and Phil Collins and stuff there.
A great class battle and no doubt it's going to continue into tomorrow.
Well, it looks like that way, and I think Frank's got his fixed again, so he's going to be out tomorrow and joining in, so it'll be good to his crack, all right?
We've got a minute, it was a minute and 16 before the last stage, so it's about 8 to 9 seconds per stage for us to get back to where we were.
Which so for a young man like you?
for a child like me against an old man like Wesley Patterson, it should be no more than a formality.
That's your kind of rally, isn't it? That is a goal.
That's absolutely so important, because actually if you don't have something to go for, you're actually more dangerous, you know. So we flat out, fully concentration, and let's go tomorrow.
And when that puncture happened, what did you think?
I didn't feel myself hit anything. I thought something had broken, or the steering broken to start with. And then eventually realised, yes, it is a puncture. So I just, we elected to drive about 8 miles, braking with a handbrake, so we didn't destroy the tyre, and the wheel wasn't damaged, and we got out of it, and we lost just about 2 minutes.
When was the last time you had a puncture?
Oh, I can't remember. It's years ago.
Honestly, did you know what to do?
I did. I knew there was a spare in the back, and I got
was it dusty?
I got a co-driver to say, Adrian, will you sort this out, please?
It's nice to have staff, isn't it?
But in the end, all he did was ended up passing me the spanner.
Good man. I like his style. So tomorrow's going to be worth watching.
Absolutely, and I hope so. You know, and the weather's like this. Let's be honest. You know, it's the beginning of October, and I've just seen a marshal wearing shorts, and we're in Cork. Something's wrong.
The end of the day wouldn't throw up any surprises. Dara O'Riordan and Tony McDade go into the overnight halt with the lead intact and a good place to start a push on day two. For Gary Jennings and Rory Kennedy, it would be second, and while they knew the championship was their main aim, the 16 seconds deficit to the lead was surely tempting them to go for the rally win too. Donna Kelly and Kevin Flanagan would still be enduring those small problems in the Focus WRC, enough to cause the pair a little loss in time on each of the stages, but they were still here and still in the fight for day two. Kevin Kelleher and Jerry Conway were doing well to keep hold of their fourth place. The car certainly a lot older than those in front, so it was expected that they would have to push that little bit more to get the best from it. And leading the group end battle would still be Owen Murphy and James O'Brien. The pair hadn't been without some scary moments, but all was going well for the pair now. Just behind Murphy and second of the Class 4 Group N runners were Sebastian Ling and Ali Dries. The Welsh visitors going well considering the competition here today. In some of the other classes, it would be a Class 1 lead for Stephen Carey and Breda O'Driscoll in the Honda Civic. While in Class 2, we see Ian Chadwick and Johnny Bold ending the day with a good lead over the Peugeot of Andrew Slattery and Sean Ford. So at the end of day one, the results look like this. How do you feel set for day two?
I'm looking forward to it now. I enjoyed today and all the stages that were good. I'm looking forward to it now.
How does it feel that your years rallying and your efforts rest on one more day here, 9 stages?
Yeah, and tomorrow's a very, very long day. You know, it's another rally. It's going to be very tricky, and try and get night's sleep tonight and think about it in the morning. But yeah, we have a good gap behind us, and you know, Dara has 18 or 19 seconds in front, so it's still all to play for. But some people want me to go for the rally winning, some people want me to win the championship. But you know, championship, as you say, we worked all year for it, we want to get it. So, but I don't want to let Dara out of my sight. You know, we took one off from that stage, so it's hard to make up my mind whether I want the rally win or I want the championship, but we'll see.
So, Breed, it was warmer in Cork today than it was in France. That's how sunny it was. But I'm just wondering if the sunshine has got to Gary Jennings tonight.
It was blissful. I've spoken to Gary Jennings and I'm wondering exactly the same thing, because he doesn't know whether to be, you know, a wee bit complacent about tomorrow, lay back and just let the championship roll into his arms, or go for the win. Is he mad in the head? A whole year's work, John.
It could all go down the Swanee tomorrow. So we'll find out what his decision is tomorrow. So for that, join us after the break. Welcome back to day two of the Cork 20 and the concluding kilometres of the Irish Tarmac Championship this year. And Breed, the conditions here have changed dramatically.
Somewhat, don't you think, John? We've gone from the Mediterranean summer conditions that we had yesterday to these treacherous, slippy, narrow, windy roads of Cork.
Who is going to deal with it best? Let's find out.
Day two would see a change in the stages, 9 in total, the last one being a repeat of the final stage of day one. But apart from that, it would all be new for the crews. So with the fresh new stages came a fresh new challenge, and suddenly the event became a lot more about survival with the slippery conditions left by the overnight and continuing rain. But for Darrow Reardon and Tony McDade, it was still looking good for the hat-trick of wins they were looking for.
Yeah, it's very slippy there now. The first one was very dangerous because it just started raining at the start. But we got through it anyway, safe enough. That wasn't too bad, that one. It was a bit of grip there, like, so.
Gary Jennings and Rory Kennedy struggle a little with the tyre choice in these opening stages. They drop a little time, but nothing serious. It just serves to extend the gap of the lead and remind them that a championship is at stake.
Well, Gary, judging the times this morning, we can't make out if you're still going for this rally win today or that you are concentrating on the championship.
No, we're definitely concentrating on the championship. I made the wrong tyre choice this morning anyway, you know, with a medium slick on there, and we're getting hammered in there, no, rightly, because disaster. But our championship in mind, we'll just keep ourselves bedded down and try and get through.
The problems on day one were continued on day two for Donna Kelly and Kevin Flanagan. The cars launched feeling on the start line and having troubles with slippery conditions. But the important thing is that Jennings was still not out of his sights.
Well, Donna, this is it. It's all to play for today, and you're going for it this morning.
I don't know what we're like in there. It was very, very slippy. We were up a bank at one stage. Our launch failed on the start line. So, I don't know. We'll see what the time's like.
Yeah, so today could leave more difficulties for you?
I hope not now, but certainly the tricky conditions this morning.
The slippery conditions were causing problems for some, but for Kevin Kelleher and John Conway, it would just be making the day a little more fun. A brave tyre choice was creating some scary moments, but it was all in hand and they lie in fourth place.
Slippery seems to be the word of the morning, Kevin. That way for you too?
Yeah, it's great fun, Breed. We went in a slick and we had some fun in the last two stages sliding around. In fairness, no, the notes were perfect. Tyre choice was a bit brave, but it was good fun.
Day two would see Sebastian Ling and Allied Rees take over the lead of Group N battle on the event. Fifth overall and leading the class by 3.5 seconds now.
Sebastian, are you finding the conditions as difficult as everyone else this morning?
Yeah, they are very difficult. That one was extremely slippy towards the end there, you know. The one before that one, we had quite a good run on. I felt confident, but I lost the confidence in there.
But Owen Murphy and James O'Brien had a good reason for the drop down to second in the class. A big moment on the first of the day's stages gave them a bit of a scare and made them back off a little. Far from off the pace, though, in sixth overall.
Are you finding the conditions as treacherous as everyone else this morning, Owen?
Yeah, it is terrible. We had a big moment there in the first stage and it just put us off for the rest of it. That stage, yeah, we seemed to have a good enough run, but the times weren't shown after the first stage. We're just trying to get the car home now.
Aside from a brave tyre choice on the opening stages, Sam Moffat and James O'Reilly would have a good run. Slippery in places, as it was for all, but they make it to the end of this loop with third in the class still in their hands.
Oh, that stage's very, very tough now. Softer compounded tyre probably would have worked a lot better. Few very big moments, but we're glad to be here. And two boys in front are pushing hard, and I don't know if I'm comfortable to push any harder, to be honest.
Stephen and Suzanne Wright were still managing to keep enough of the gap between them and Josh Moffat for the championship Group N battle, not getting carried away with the overall and lying in eighth place.
It's definitely not simple now. Conditions are very tough this morning. They're very greasy and definitely a lack of grip in there, but it's the same for everybody. So I suppose for us it's a matter of just trying to be careful and get around and as best we can. But yeah, it'll not be easy, that's for sure.
So Josh Moffat and John Rowan had a fair amount to do if they were to beat Wright, and they weren't going to do that on these stages. Unable to get any heat into the tyres, it was proving a difficult battle for the championship honours.
Yeah, after yesterday's bad luck, we have a lot of work to do today, but we're going to go and see what happens. It's a long day. That stage in there was wild slippy. It was hard to get heat into the back tyres, but we had good fun anyway.
And we see a new face in the top 10 as Class 1 leaders Stephen Carey and Breda O'Driscoll step up into that 10th place in the Honda Civic. Day 2 for the National Rally, and it would be all about the conditions, rain making the stages slippery for all, and Roy White and Liam Brennan were no exception. But the four-wheel drive was certainly helping, and they lead the way by over 3 minutes now. The difference in conditions is very evident today, Roy.
Yeah, it's been very, very slippy out there. We didn't make a bad tyre choice, we haven't been going too bad, but it's treacherous out there, you know.
The theme of the weekend was fun for Wesley Patterson and Sean Head. This morning's stages may be slippy, but that just meant more sideways, something which the fans on the stages would argue is how it should be.
Wesley, so far so good, or have you just noticed how dangerous this day is going to be?
It's turned out to be really slippy this morning. That's more like a forestry stage in places in there, but good fun to try, but just very slippy.
Phil Collins and Adrian Deasy were having a much better morning than they did yesterday. They dragged themselves back up to third place as they hunt down Patterson for that second place. 44 seconds the difference now.
You've got an uphill battle today as well, Phil, but I think you're going to enjoy this one.
We're going to enjoy it, but slippery. This was not in the agenda. I thought it was going to be really dry this morning. Jesus, it's left and right and all over the place, but our challenge is ahead. We're doing the best to make it.
You've had a taste of what to expect, at least.
Boy, oh boy, I hope it doesn't get any worse. The demonstration, Frank Kelly joined on Super Rally this morning, the end of the first stage. He spun it, he's hit the wing off, he's hit the back off. It's so easy to do it. So we just got to be careful we don't fall into that trap.
This means it's a step back down into fourth for Jim McKenna and Thomas Trainer. Another pair to suffer with the conditions and not knowing what tyre choice is best on the car. For Jason Ryan and Tygo Sullivan, it would be back down to fifth. They still lead the class and lie just 15 seconds behind McKenna now. Day 2 would of course be the first we see of the juniors, and after two stages it would be John O'Flaherty and Tommy Command that come out on top, but it was very close, just 1 second in fact, as Callum Devine and Liam McLaughlin in the Citroen C2 give them plenty to watch out for in second place. Gary and Breen McNamee end the first two stages in third place, a great start considering they had never driven the Civic on a wet stage before. Darren Young and PJ O'Dowd were, however, making sure things didn't all go too well for those in front. Just 0.5 seconds separated them from the car in front, so it was all still to play for. For Dennis Nagel and Donagh Crowley, it would be fifth place, a result that maybe could have been a little higher up if it hadn't been for an intermittent misfire over the morning stages. And for Thomas Creedon and Eamon Creedon, it would be sixth overall. They do hold second in the class though, 26 seconds behind Nagel. Midway through day 2, and not much was set to change at the top. Dara O'Riordan and Tony McDade continued their dominance of the event with a 35 second lead now. The pressure may have been getting to Gary Jennings and Rory Kennedy a little in this loop. A few small and silly mistakes started to creep in, but so far nothing serious, and second was still theirs. Yeah. John O'Kelly and Kevin Flanagan wouldn't be without mistakes too. A small off in this loop losing them a few seconds, but they still lie just 16 seconds behind Jennings. Kevin Kelleher and Ger Conway were still having a good run. They remain in fourth place, this loop seeing them set a fastest time and chip away at the crews ahead. Unfortunately, we lose Sebastian Ling in this stage when his car spins out and doesn't make the end of the stage. Which means it's back into that Group N lead at this point in the event for Owen Murphy and James O'Brien. The pair with a good 38 seconds lead, the most comfortable it has been all weekend. And that lead would be over Sam Moffat and James O'Reilly. The pair, like Murphy, had been slowed a little at the scene of Sebastian Ling's off, but the time lost didn't change the results. And it would be the same for Stephen and Suzanne Wright. But for the pair, the times didn't matter much. All they needed to do was to stay ahead of Josh Moffat, which they were doing. The gap really hadn't changed all day for Josh Moffat and John Rowan. Had they not had the problems on day one, things could have been closer. But for now, all they could do was keep up and hope for a change. Good news for Class 1 runners Stephen Carey and Breed O'Driscoll too in the Civic, as they make a further step up into 9th with the loss of Sebastian Ling. And Rory Byrne and Mark Bowens join us in the top 10, the Evo driver getting used to the stages and the car to set some good times. So midway through day 2 and the results look like this.
Have you got anything you know about the weather this afternoon, what you might do with the tyres? Will you change anything, do you think, or keep things as they are?
We're going to go out in the same tyres again now for the next two, because they're still a bit damp and there's mud and stuff in places, so we'll just go with what we had there, and if it's drier, then we have other tyres there. We have slicks then for the afternoon, so we'll see, hopefully it'll be the right tyre or not.
And it won't be slow, will it?
Well, no, the two of them, they're two fast stages, so they're the safer option to go with what we have, so we'll go with them and hopefully it'll work.
Is that good news you're reading there from Patterson Pace Notes, or is that bad news?
My only problem is I can't read.
You only need to know the numbers.
No, it's grand, it's good here. Just a long way to go.
I sense from seeing you on 11 and 10, you're just backing off a little bit and thinking, no, the rally win's not possible. You got to think about the championship.
Yeah, we didn't come here to win the rally. We come here to win the championship, and that's what we're trying to do. But it's so difficult. Like, we stalled in that stage and probably dropped a handful of seconds. And that's not me. I never stall these cars. Just get the foot down. But no, I'm just nervous now. But we'll see. We've four demand stages and then one home after that. So five to go.
Don, it doesn't matter how fast you go. We've got to find a way of spooking Gary, haven't we?
Yeah, we're nipping away at him there this morning. We were off on the third stage today. We were in a hedge. It didn't cost too much, maybe 4 or 5 seconds, but upset the rhythm a bit, but we're trying.
So Gary's spooking you.
There's a wasp here.
Hey, maybe that's the secret. We'll get a wasp in his car.
Get it into Rory's throat.
That might do the trick.
Yeah, no, it's fast out there this morning, and we're having a good run, so... still our problems with our launch, but we're driving around it and we're enjoying it.
There are still 5 stages to go at this point, and as we know, there's a little bit of drama often out there on the final loop, and I guess you just got to hope you keeping the speed up and something happens to him.
Well, you know, we're going to keep pushing. I think there's 18 or 19 seconds between us. You know, it's not insurmountable, so we're going to keep pushing and see what happens.
That's fighting talk. That's what we like.
Well, we're here for a fight.
So listen, that's a lead of a minute. You could park up, have a look at the beautiful scenery, check the weather, get back in and still win.
I don't know about that now. A minute's not that long when you've Josh Moffat behind you. So we've went out this morning and tried to conserve our lead and not let him gain too much. So maybe we can start coming back another bit now. But it's definitely
it's hard to sort of drive with your head all the time, you know.
What's it like doing the maths in the car, taking and adding from 60?
Oh, well, we're not, you know, we're just sort of looking at stage by stage, and if he's not taking a lot of time out, we're not thinking into it too much more than that, because at the, we need to keep our rhythm going, and if you just get too caught up in the whole thing, you might lose it, so.
How difficult is it keeping your rhythm when you're thinking, this is it, this is the win?
It's tricky now, and when we came across Sebastian Ling on the last stage as well, it definitely sort of it knocked our confidence a bit, and struggled to concentrate for the rest of the stage, but we're managing all right so far.
As the event starts to draw to a close, there wouldn't be much change, or at least not to the results. The weather, however, would change, and conditions became very slippery in the afternoon stages. But getting through them with no problems, Dara O'Riordan and Tony McDade maintain a good lead of the event. The conditions would make for some interesting moments, moments that Gary Jennings and Rory Kennedy could do without. The nerves already building in the car as the event gets into its final stages. All they want to do is get a clean run to the end. And the same could be said for Donna Kelly and Kevin Flanagan, although it was going a little worse for them. They spin and lose around 15 seconds here, making the gap to Jennings 24 seconds, the biggest it has been so far. Worst problems would face Kevin Kelleher and Jer Conway on the same corner. They go off with a little more of a bang, damaging the front end of the Impreza and losing a similar amount of time to the Focus pair. Luckily, mostly cosmetic, they get the car to the end of the loop and into service for a better look. Owen Murphy and James O'Brien continue to lead the group end battle, the pair getting back into it after their earlier scare. And for Stephen and Suzanne Wright, it would still be a good position for the group end championship. They still lead their rival Josh Moffat by almost a minute now.
Do you feel Gary is maybe just dropping back a little bit because he does have the championship to think about?
Yeah, like I think he's watching Donna Kelly's times and I'm watching Gary's times, and we're just trying to stay the same and not take any risks. So it's hard to find a pace what to go at. Like, but I think we're going all right anyway. So we're safe. I think we're going safe enough. So hopefully, you know, we can keep it up.
Are you keeping the nerves at bay?
Well, there's nothing else left in my stomach now. But yeah, I'm a very nervous person anyway when I'm rallying. So. No, I'd say I'd be nervous when maybe the last one, but no, the right man beside me, Rory's a good man of that, and he can settle me, and he knows to pull me back a bit in the notes, so yeah, we'll be okay.
Over the next couple of stages, the conditions would be worse for all, but for Roy White and Liam Brennan, it would still be the lead, the pair not losing any time, and still comfortable in that place. Wesley Patterson and Sean Hayde would be caught out by the conditions, in the same place as many others were. They overshoot on this junction, but don't lose a massive amount of time. This did give Phil Collins and Adrian Deasy a bit of chance to catch up, or at least it would have done if they didn't make a mistake themselves. Luckily, not as much time lost for the pair, as they only briefly stall the car before getting going again. Jim McKenna and Thomas Traynor weren't having as much trouble. They have their share of sideways moments, but nothing they couldn't handle, and they remain in that fourth place. Fifth place, though, was now occupied by John Hickey and John McCarthy in the 4x4 Escort, the pair making the most of the four-wheel drive and moving up into that place. This was at the cost of Jason Ryan and Tygo Sullivan, who are forced down into sixth, even with this efficient recovery on the slippery corner. On to the final stages of the event then, and a look at how the results were decided. In Class 9 there wouldn't be any change, as Declan Murphy and Daniel Hanratty bring the car home second in the class behind event long leaders Timmy Foley and Barry Mead, who win the class with a substantial lead. Kieran Casey and Irla McCarthy settle for second in Class 10 after a good battle, ending up just 27 seconds behind the Nova of class winners, Victor and Susan Beamish. Paul Brown and Jenna Brown take the runner-up place in Class 11F as they finish almost 6 minutes behind the starlet of sixth overall Jason Ryan and Tago Sullivan. John O'Sullivan and Denny O'Riordan finished the event in 20th overall, 7 minutes behind class rivals Paul Fitzgerald and Pierce Donaghy Jr., who bring the escort home in 10th overall too. Sean Hickey and Noel Fleming have a good run in the starlet to finish second in class 12. They finish behind the escort of Gerard O'Connell and Tony Hennessy. Danny Creedon and Jill White managed to get to the end of the event as the sole finishers in Class 15. And in Class 16, it would be the runner-up spot for Jared and James Lucy in the Evo, unable to keep up with the flying Civic of Shane Keneally and Eamon Hart in the class lead. In the Asterix, there wouldn't be much change. James Power and Declan Kelly still round off the category in the Escort, second in the class also. John Spires and Susan McCollum drop a little time on day two and drop down into fifth place in the Porsche, which means it's a step up to fourth for James O'Mahony and Kerry Barry, the pair more than happy with the finish and becoming the historic champions for 2013. No change in the top three, we see Aidan O'Connor and Ian Regan bring home the Escort in third, a good way off the rally leaders though. The duo of course take the class win in the C3 class. The top two historics would be quite a way ahead of the rest, with second place going to Dennis Moynihan and Shane Buckley in the Escort. The pair had a good run all weekend to finish just over a minute off the lead. But the win this time out would go to Mark Falvey and Peter Scott, the local event for Mark, and in a significant car. So this result was a great win for the Escort pair.
Preston, three left and five right. Sloan, five right. Five. Opens. 3:50. One right, 100, and then over a dip. 80. Easy now, on high speed. One right, one left, over crest. 170. Slippery braking. It's slippy braking. Turn square right. Easy. Well done. Right, turn square right. Just make sure it's not slippy again. Okay, finished.
No change in sixth place of the juniors for Thomas and Eamon Creedon. Their sixth place finish also gets them second in the class. Kieran O'Donoghue and John Falvey make good time on the second half of the day and move up from seventh into fifth place, a great result for the Civic pair. Dennis Nagel and Jonah Crowley seem to manage through the misfire and end the day one place up in fourth, this despite some scary moments throughout the day. For Gary and Breen McNamee, there would be no change. They started the day in third and ended there too. A podium place this weekend was a good result to take away. Darren Young and PJ O'Dowd make good progress through the day to move up the results, but sadly only as far as second. The pair end the day as the runner-up crew in the juniors. But it would be a win for Callum Devine and Liam McLaughlin. The pair move up from second to take the top spot after the loss of John O'Flaherty from that place earlier in the event when he drops down into 11th place. On to the overall results, it would be 5th for John Hickey and John McCarthy. The pair battled with the conditions to take that place midway through day 2 and kept hold of it to the end. For Jim McKenna and Thomas Treanor, it would be 4th. They had been in and around the top of the results all weekend, and this finish was a good result in the conditions this weekend. The mission Phil Collins and Adrian Deasy set themselves after their day 1 puncture didn't quite go to plan, but the drive to get there was a great one. The times in the end down to just 23 seconds, but it would be Wesley Patterson and Sean Haidt who make it back in second place, with the rally leader running away with the win. This was a kind of a best of the rest situation. and the pair kept their cool to come out on the podium. But as expected, it would be Roy White and Liam Brennan that end the event as the National Rally winners. The pair end the day with a 4.5 minute lead, a lead that never looked in doubt. Well, you can't say that wasn't an enjoyable run today. It was flawless.
No, we had a great run today. We had a great run all weekend. The event was brilliant. So compact. The stages were superb. There was loads of driving in them. No, I can't say enough good things. I hope it comes back here again next year. It was a brilliant place for a rally.
You've had so much success with this car during the year, and I know a lot of the success is down to Mount Tune as well.
Yeah, they built this a really, really cracking engine, you know, so it didn't miss a beat all year long, and we've been giving it a bit of punishment.
A fantastic finale to the season for you. Any plans for 2014 yet?
No plans yet, but I don't think much will change, so it'll be the same pony again next year.
So, at the end of the National Rally, here's a reminder of the results. So, with the event almost complete, just the final three stages remained. And in Class 2, we would see Andrew Slattery and Sean Ford in the Peugeot come home second in the class. They are beaten to the top spot by Ian Chadwick and Johnny Bold in the Skoda, who win by over a minute and a half. On to the top 10, and rounding off the top 10 are Stephen Carey and Breda O'Driscoll, the pair also taking the win in Class 1. Rory Byrne and Mark Bowens bring the Eagle 10 in 9th place. Unfortunately for Josh Moffat and John Rowan, it would be second in the battle for the Group N Championship. They finished the day off in 8th overall and 4th in class. But for Stephen and Suzanne Wright, 7th overall and 3rd in the class means a place better than their rivals and the Group N Championship win for 2013. A great result for the pair in the ex-Gary Jennings Championship winning car.
Well, guys, it was a very competitive season in Group N, but you kept your cool. You've taken the win here today, which means you've taken the win in the championship. What a lot of pressure to have on the last round.
Yeah, it was a long 2 days now, I have to say. We had a bit of a gap from the first loop when Josh ran into trouble, and it wasn't easy trying to maintain that gap and bring it home. The pressure was on, but we tried to put it to the back of our mind as best we can and get on with it. And I have to say, Suzanne made that job a whole lot easier because she did a faultless job as usual, and the car was also perfect thanks to Keith Rainey and the lads as well. It was just everything just worked out well.
So much of the success is down to the co-driver, Suzanne. You have done a fantastic job all year. You knew that Stephen couldn't be complacent at any time during this rally.
Yeah, Stephen did a brilliant job today. There's a lot of pressure. It was nearly harder having that gap and trying not to lose it. It was ours to lose today, and he kept his head and did a brilliant job, as he did all year. And we're just absolutely delighted. And again, thanks to Keith and the rest of the team who made it possible. The car's been brilliant all year.
So now you have this championship win under your belt. What are your intentions for next year, Steve?
We're not too sure yet. We're looking at a number of options. We've been nominated for the Billy Coleman Award, so we have to sort of think long and hard about that before the interview stage. But hopefully, if that falls our way, it might open a few doors. But there's certainly a lot of other great drivers up for it too, so it won't be easy.
Well, best of luck with the success that this brings.
Thank you.
For Sam Moffat and James O'Reilly, it would be second in class, stuck in the middle of the overall and the championship battle. They end the event 6th overall. But for Owen Murphy and James O'Brien, it would be the Group N win, taking the victory by just 32 seconds after 2 days of very close rallying. A great result for the Cork man on an occasional outing on tarmac.
What a finale to your season. You came here, you wanted to take 4 in a row. You done it.
Yeah, I think that's our 4th win on Group N here in the Cork 20, so it's been absolutely fantastic. We were doing the last round of the Forestry Championship last week in Oma, but unfortunately we didn't get past the first stage. We were leading at the time, so it's great to finish the year on a high note, and we look forward to the next show.
It's been a fantastic season, and the competition in Group N has been amazing this year.
It's amazing, yeah. We were only 8-9 seconds off the World Rally Cars and stages. These guys are pushing really hard, but we're happy now we have the same pace on tarmac we have in gravel.
Kevin Keller and Jerk Conway escape any further drama to end the event in fourth. A slightly slow start on day one was soon rectified, and the pair got themselves right back in the mix at the top of the results. Unfortunately for Donagh Kelly and Kevin Flanagan, this weekend wasn't meant to be. They miss out on the championship win here at the final round, but they knew that they had to come into this with some of the outcome out of their hands. Third overall this weekend, though, was a great finish. And bringing it home for the third win in a row here in Cork are Darrow Reardon and Tony McDade. A faultless drive all weekend from the pair sees them take victory. The only pair to win 3 years in a row since the great Billy Coleman back in the 70s. So this result really will be a special one for the team. But that means that keeping a sensible head and not making any mistakes brings Gary Jennings to the finish in second place. And more importantly for him, 2013 Irish Tarmac Rally Champion. A season which wasn't perfect, came out well in the end, and the emotion was clear to see at the end of the final stage.
Gary Jennings, you are now Tarmac Champion of Ireland.
Yeah, it's been a long weekend, it's been a long year, but oh, it's great to get over that finish line.
I bet the relief is fantastic.
Yeah, I think it's more relief than anything else. It's been building up this all year, and it was going to come down to the wire, and I think it's been more nerves all weekend, but fair bit of Dara, he did very well. We just made sure he's going to make no mistakes, and he made no mistakes, but fantastic to win the championship.
Gary, you've had a few people help you this season to make the dream come true.
Yeah, without a doubt. Our whole team, all our sponsors, our tyre suppliers have all put everything behind us to do this. And it wasn't looking great at the start of the year. We were only sixth in Galway, but we've come through with a third place in Donegal and a win in Ulster and a win in Killarney and a second place here. So, yeah, very good.
And what were you like before the start of that very last stage? How was it feeling?
It was very good, except there was a 10-minute delay, so I had to sit out. But no, I knew we just lived through that stage with very little anti-lag on, and we talked to ourselves, Rory talked me through it, and we got round the last slippy bend. I think that was it, just get to the finish line.
And a quick word for Rory, who saw you around today, a super performance from him.
Yeah, fantastic. You know, it was very important to bring Rory here because he's experienced at doing this. You know, it's one thing going to win a rally, but it's another thing coming to get points to win a championship, and fantastic. It's just pity we didn't win the rally because he's won it twice with Bertie Fisher before. It'd be nice to get his third, but he'll be happy knowing the title goes back to Fermanagh now from the first time since the Fisher tragedy, so for him as well.
Gary Jennings, champion, well done, thank you. Kesh and Fermanagh are celebrating tonight. You better get away and join them.
Thank you.
Well, even though there may have been a championship battle on, you had your own aim here this weekend, and that was to take the hat-trick of wins in the Cork 20 International. You done it. You kept your cool.
Yeah, I thought it was coming in, we weren't that confident because just the couple of different things over the year and with offs and things, so we weren't that confident coming in, but it would have been nice to win. But yeah, it was just a tough rally. Like Saturday we were going well, but today then we kind of had to maintain a pace and keep an eye on Gary's times and seeing with Donagh Kelly and just see where we were, and it was difficult and the conditions then and everything, but it was nice. Now that last loop was nerve-wracking, all right, but it was great. Like
the Tarmac Championship brought us all over the country this year to win your home event. I'm sure it means a lot to you.
Oh, it does. Like the Cork 20 is one of my favourite rallies, and it is my home rally as well, but to win it three times, you know, like I never thought I'd do it three times.
Well, not only does that wrap up the Cork 20 International Rally, but it brings to an end the 2013 Tarmac Rally Championship. And what a nail-biter, especially that last 7 kilometres.
It's going to be a double celebration, isn't it, Bree? But it was very tight towards the end. But look, we've got Darrow Reardon winning the rally, and we've got Gary Jennings, Tarmac Champion of Ireland 2013. Which, hang on a second, that means there's two parties for you and I to go to. So we better get a wiggle on.